we're going to talk about unleashing the potential of advertising on OTT. And on this panel, we have with us some stellar personalities from the industry. Welcoming Shashank Srivastava, Executive Director, Maruti Suzuki, Ms. Anurita Chopra, Area Marketing Lead, Oral Care, GSK Consumer Healthcare, Ashwin Padmanabhan, President, Partnerships and Trading Group M, Mr. Prateek Gupta, Co-Founder, Foxy Moron and Zoo Media. And chairing the session is Neeta Nair, Assistant Editor, Exchange for Media. A very warm welcome to everyone.
So hello and welcome once again to E4M Play. Now, OTT was clearly the buzzword of 2020. And it was literally the year when OTT platforms became mainstream, with peak budget movie releases, binge-worthy shows like Patal Log, Mirzapur, 1992 Scam, and many, many more. And many mediums were struggling for revenues, ad revenues. You know, most OTT platforms were enjoying all the attention from advertisers, even at the peak of the pandemic. And that's exactly what we're here to discuss today in our session, Unleashing the Potential of Advertising on OTT. And to discuss that, I have with me amazing leaders from the industry. Let me introduce Shashank Srivastava, Executive Director, Maruti Suzuki. Hi, Shashank.
Hi, good to be here.
We have Anurita Chopra, Area Lead, Oral Care, GSK Healthcare. Hi, Anurita.
Hello, everyone.
We have Ashwin Padmanabhan, President, Partnerships and Trading at Group M.
Hi, everybody. Lovely to be here.
And we have Prateek Gupta, co-founder of Foxy Moron and Zoom Media.
Hi, guys. Hi, everybody.
And I'm Neeta Nair, assistant editor with Impact Magazine and also the moderator for this session. So let me direct the first question to you, Mr. Srivastava. Now, Maruti has traditionally been a very strong advertiser on TV. Now, when did OTT assume a place of importance in your marketing mix and why?
Well, I think talking of Maruti Suzuki, we are a substantial advertiser, as you know. Our spends are close to 700 crores, out of which television last year was the largest, still at around 30%, and digital was 28%, as also print. We do a lot of tactical and print. On OTT, we actually started seeing some real strong trends in the last couple of years. And we saw the consumer behavior itself changing as far as viewing is concerned. And with the larger penetration of the internet and the possibility of streaming on internet, a lot of platforms which were on based on streaming on internet have gained prominence. So you have video, you have so many of these platforms, you have this Netflix and the Amazon Prime and so on. You also have audio. So you have Spotify and you also have messaging like WhatsApp or including voice, for example, which is over Skype. So all these are actually part of OTT platform. It's just streaming on. But what we are, I think, focusing today is on OTT platform as far as video on demand is concerned. And we saw this trend emerging last couple of years because not only was the digital percentage increasing. Digital percentage in 2019 actually was just around 20%, but it's gone up to probably about 30 now and expected to be 34%. Video also has gone up. In fact, the growth projections are 30%. And that gives OTT an edge because OTT has a lot of positives which television doesn't have. There's more personalized, more individual individual watching. You can watch it across devices. The cost is lower. You have actually 450 million smartphones, for example, as compared with 200 million television sets. So I think all these trends got together and we have been observing that since the pandemic started, actually this has been further accelerated. We find OTT as a very, very strong medium for which we would be advertising, not only doing it currently, but also in future, we expect it to get much larger from our distribution.
Okay, interesting. Ms. Chopra, what kind of increase have you seen in the amount of spend GSK dedicates to OTT when you compare it with the pre-pandemic?
Well, actually, Neeta, the way to look at it is not so much in terms of pre and post, but we always knew OTT is definitely a platform to consider and to, you know, gain prominence. I keep saying, and I was, you know, talking to you the other day as well, that be where the river flows. And if the consumer is really taking to OTT as a platform for her regular entertainment and is looking and enjoying fresh content out there, then clearly as advertisers, it is only but natural that we'll also find our way to be able to reach a consumer exactly there. So it's totally evolutionary. Yes, the pandemic has actually led up to a height of consumption, or possibly because of the same old jaded content on regular television, and therefore fresh content sitting out here, more relevant and youthy content, vernacular content, and so many more avenues. And especially personalized content, which makes it so relevant for different kinds of cohorts to find it, compelling to come back. So I think one is the comebackability, one is compelling content, and therefore, by definition, we'll definitely be there, and the spends will only increase.
My next question is to you, Mr. Padmanabhan. Now, the first wave was phenomenal for the business of OTT platforms. Now we're facing the second wave. Is it going to be just as beneficial for these platforms? And today, can we say literally all the key advertisers in the space are present on OTT platforms, new age and traditional, everybody?
I think, honestly, the way we see it, the challenge is less to do with demand from advertisers or demand from consumers. We clearly have more consumers consuming content on OTT. Driven by all the factors that have been discussed even in the earlier session. And at the same time, there are more and more advertisers wanting to come onto the platform. I think the larger challenge is that advertising can be done only on the AVOD side of the platform. A lot of the content that is getting released today and a lot of the eyeballs that we are seeing on the platforms are actually on the SVOD side, which is leading to a challenge from an advertising perspective, which is that honestly, there are not enough impressions available to really deliver a campaign in its entirety. And especially, like Shashank said, if you want to leverage the advantage of targeting, you want to leverage the advantage of probably looking at audiences in a certain cut, the more you slice and dice it, you actually start figuring out that impressions are not available really for you to target. So if you ask me, the larger question is, from a strategic perspective for OTT platforms, how do they invest more on content, which actually powers the AVOD side of their business? And I think that's what we'll need to really work on.
You know, I'd like to touch upon something that Ms. Chopra said, the fresh content part of it. Mr. Gupta, a big factor which has kind of helped OTT poach a good amount of viewership from, GECs in the beginning of last year, was that there was repeat content on TV and fresh content relatively on OTT. Now, as far as the current wave is concerned, both TV and OTT are better prepared. Shoots have not completely stopped. So would you say OTT would still have an edge when it comes to, the overall scheme of things?
So as opposed to what, what live television content does, right? OTTs or the shows are planned a lot more in advance, right? The reason that the Primes and the Netflix and the Hotstars of the world were still doing fairly well during the first wave of the pandemic was primarily because their content was ready and available, I think, 4 to 6 months in advance, as opposed to, on television where there is regular content that's being created, which is live. So there is a constant flux of content being made available, right? As far as where we are sitting today, the demand for content is far greater than the supply. And, we're seeing this across all of the platforms that that we're actually operating inside. And the advantage that that we had during the pandemic was the fact that we started off, understanding that India is a one television home. But honestly, today, the number of people in the house is equal to the number of screens that they have access to, right? So suddenly the control of the audience was onto their cell phones, the control of their audience was onto their laptops, the control of their audience was onto a tablet, if at all. And suddenly that one home, which would otherwise have been fighting for control of that remote control during a lockdown or a pandemic, had access to so many more options to watch this content. Mm-hmm. And know, from a consumer's point of view, the choice, you know, was varied. They had the ability to watch different kind of content as opposed to watch either a Ramayana, Mahabharata, or, you know, like, or the news or sports, depending on, you know, who wore the, you know, who wore the pants in the house. You know, they suddenly had the option to choose. And more importantly for us, what also gave advertisers the ability to latch on is that they could target the person in the house who was viewing the content, right? So if you look at it from a supply side and a demand side, whether it's content or whether it's advertising, you know, inventory availability, I think OTT was sitting at a pleasant spot. It was anyways growing, right? Like Anurita said, right? Like it was where the river was flowing. It just that, you know, somebody opened the water gates a lot more, and, you know, the flow increased. And, you know, we're all sitting here having this conversation today.
We spoke about targeting, and, you know, I'd like to bring in both the media experts here. You know, if I were to compare OTT with the most popular platforms for content like YouTube or social media, you know, there were instances in the past where Unilever threatened to pull back all the advertising revenue from these platforms because content was, their ads were being aired with content which was inappropriate. Now, would you say brand safety is a very important point that goes in favor of OTT platforms today when you compare it with the rest? Because that's kind of checked and authorized in a way.
Absolutely. I think surely a lot of the content, I won't say all, but surely a lot of the content, a higher percentage of the content which is there on OTT is surely can be classified as brand safe. That's one. The second is the nature of the consumer, so the way the consumer, you know, actually looks at the content and, you know, consumes the content means that the engagement rates are also much higher. The completion rates are also much higher in an OTT environment. So yes, from that perspective, OTT makes it more effective. But where and I'm going to go back to my previous point, because that actually is going to make or break the whole story of OTT. Today, the scale of impressions available on OTT is minuscule compared to all the other platforms that you're talking about, right? So unless and until there's a strategic investment that is made towards increasing the available impressions on the AVOD side, we are always going to be talking about the potential that exists, but we are unable to realize, right? Mm-hmm. So if you ask me the one biggest question that the platforms need to answer is, how do I create more impressions on the AVOD side if I want more advertising monies to come to me? That's probably the biggest bottleneck today.
Mm-hmm. But, you know, it's right, because, you know, the video completion rates to some extent is high on OTT, but at the same time compared to YouTube, I mean, but yet industry specific measures like, you know, click-through rates, I mean, they don't really hold for OTT channels, right, as much.
No, I guess we all use, you know, different mediums for different purposes, right? So if I'm doing a performance marketing campaign, maybe I will not use OTT. But at the same time, if I'm driving brand building, which is what we traditionally use TV for, I would surely want to use OTT. So as a potential, I guess OTT holds a lot of potential, and I have no doubt that it is going to grow substantially. But at this point in time, there is a lot of promise, but I would say delivery is still under delivery in terms of what is available.
Anita, I'd just like to chime in there with the fact that, like, exactly what Ashwin said. It also is, you're on YouTube because you are going through like a cluster of content that you're consuming at that particular point in time, right? So you have, you know, distracted viewing as what we would call it, right? Like, I would watch half a YouTube video, move back into Facebook, move back into Instagram, come back onto YouTube. Versus when I'm on an OTT platform, I have focused viewing, right? And also the inventory that's sold on OTT is also like a cost per completed view versus an inventory that's sold on YouTube would be a CPM inventory where there is an ability to click out, and that's a parameter that you're actually gauging, right? Like, it's basically different horses for different courses, and, you know, that's what it is. And there is a problem in understanding of all of the different metrics that are available in the OTT ecosystem, and people are using different things for, you know, different means, which needs to standardize a lot more. But it's the starting of the learning curve, honestly, and everybody will get there slowly but steadily.
Okay. You know, I'd like to come to the advertisers now. You know, the same question that I asked earlier. brand safety, of course, is very key for, you know, as far as any advertiser is concerned. But even today, we're seeing a lot of cases like, you know, Tandav. There are these web series like Tandav, Patal Lok, which have been mired in controversy because of, you know, hurting religious sentiments and all of that. So how do you pick and choose your content? You know, are you very, very sure? You have to be very, very sure about where you're placing your money. You don't want to be seen against, you know, around provoking religious sentiments or anything like that. So how do you go about picking the content? Anuradha?
That's a good question. And of course, you know, as brands, you always look for the right fit. You know, I think what you need to be very clear about, what is the role that ODT is going to play for you in your strategy? And I think Ashwin and Pratik both have made pertinent points on that, which is, look, if you're looking for reach and frequency, then obviously you will go for the tried and tested, because you're looking at metrics, you're looking at deliveries, you know that this is going to have a straight-jacketed tie back to business in actual numbers. Definitely in the digital world as well, now we have at least reach builder platforms, and so that's relatively more measurable now than what it used to be. So similarly, OTT will go through that churn, will go through that evolution by definition, you know, because obviously all advertisers, all media experts are going to be hounding on everybody's door saying, listen, give us the metrics, and why would we put more money? Because yes, this is glamorous, and yes, this is clearly where the preference is going, but we need hard numbers to be able to convince our clients in the first place, or advertisers who are going to divert their funds out here. So that's one. But second, I think, you know, just like brand ambassador fitment, just like property genre fitment. So say a brand like Sensodyne, which is, you know, very, very, upmarket. Not that we don't cater to lower tier consumers, we do. But as a brand tonality, you intuitively know whether you are going to be, you know, associating with a certain genre of programming content or not. You know the kind of vein it will be, whether it serves your purpose or not. For that matter, definitely, you know, we partnered with Hotstar for Game of Thrones. Sure, because the role out there is impact. So if you're very clear about what your role, what achievement you want, whether you want to create impact, and, you know, to Ashwin's point, so if it's a launch buzz that you want to create, you want to quickly drive visibility, you want to quickly drive awareness, sure, by all means. But then be a little flexible on the metrics, and therefore that determines the kind of spends also that you will put. Because obviously there is only that much, fuzz that you have in your budget. The others are very, very tightly measured and locked and performance driven. So by definition, all said and done, it's a matter of time before metrics will start coming in, because the channel or the platform is only getting bigger. So they have to.
Okay. And coming to you, Mr. Srivastava, would you go with metrics and, you know, monthly active users and all of that while picking your, picking a show to associate with? Or is it going to be how powerful the content can be and how you can associate well with it? What is the balance for you?
Yeah. So of course, it's rarely that, to get to a particular marketing objective, you talk only of one platform. So it's not always an OTT versus something else. It is maybe OTT plus television, for example. It is not just digital versus legacy media or traditional media. It is also what that plus something. So it's I think what we need to shift the debate here is not about OTT, how it is as an exclusive platform, but how it adds to your overall marketing investment objectives. On the specific thing of how to invest in OTT, of course, you will look at the content preference of the target audience. And I think that is the number one priority for us. Of course, you look also at the monthly active users if you are choosing between platforms, or maybe the cross-visiting data across platforms. So you would have some platforms which have, which have a larger cross-visiting ratios, which we would like to minimize the duplication. Oh, that is all part of this thing. So for us, it is largely the content, and then of course the usual metrics which any investment involves. But I think the discussion which we have been hearing so far, and what Ashwin also pointed out is a question of I think we are not debating whether OTT will get bigger. It will get bigger. I think there is a general consensus. And as Anurita said, wherever you have people, you will have advertisers will go there. So I think there is no debate. Prateek also talked about, you know, how OTT is better and probably why it is growing. So you have, you know, multiple, you can have it, seeing it across devices. It's a on-demand viewing rather than appointment viewing of television. It's more individualistic. You can have as many screens in the household as you have number of people. You can, you know, the number of smartphones are increasing. Internet penetration is increasing. Data, and there is no debate then, therefore, that there is will be a growth. The question is it advantageous for the OTT as a platform to advertise? And there also, I think there is a broad consensus, and I believe all panel members here also agree to that, that it leads to a much sharper targeting. Absolutely no doubt. It is more open and more amenable to micro-targeting, whether it is demographics or it is geo-targeting, whether it is, you know, even interest cohorts. I think Anurita talked about interest cohorts or even device targeting. Content targeting is one of the major things which, you know, advertisers are looking at. You can even look at day part targeting, like we do for all models. Viewer engagement is much more. Ashwin said that it leads to a much more stickiness and even binge watching, as we all know. We have immediate response, and I think somewhere OTT is also improving. And people are realizing that if you have more clickable CTAs, as is possible if you are viewing it on mobile, if you incorporate things like an online shopping within the OTT experience, maybe it is much people would quickly call up retail stores or maybe visit the brand website. Customer acquisition is therefore much better, I would say. There is more brand safety. I think Ashwin pointed it out rightly that there is clearly, while there are exceptions, but clearly there is more brand safety. And more importantly, which I think so far we have not touched upon, is that remarketing is possible, because OTT actually is a digital media. So your customer give you those digital signals. So brands can actually leverage multiple parts of online ad environments, you know, multiple devices, multiple channels. You can address a single cohort using combination of streaming advertisements, social media, and so on. And finally, that's the last point I would like to make, is that yes, Ashwin's point, I think, is the central point, which is when you look at SVOD and when you look at AVOD, you have in India, of course, there is at the moment, I think 30-35% is SVOD, but maybe in abroad, it is almost 90 plus in US, for example. So there is a challenge. You have everything going for the platform, but is it monetizable? Is it something which, and that is where the innovation will come in. And I believe in India, while we have the AVOD content is still big. And I think where the advertisers will really have to innovate, as also the platform itself, is how much branded content you can get in. So while in SVOD, you know, it's difficult to have those small advertisements. But if you want to really do a branded storytelling, you can really do it using content integration, or you have branded content. And remember, for people like Maruti Suzuki, we are a fairly well-known brand. So our challenge is not so much awareness, as much as engagement. And OTT provides that. So I'm actually quite excited about the future of the OTT, including a lot of innovations that needs to be done. And I think that's what Ashwin was pointing out too. It would require a lot of innovation for it to become relevant for advertisers in a large way, as is the case with other mediums.
So Ashwin, in that, and thank you so much, Shashank. There were a couple of things that have come up. I mean, a lot of questions I have to ask you and the panelists after what you said. Ashwin, so of course, as of now, what we understand is OTT is great as far as the upper funnel of marketing is concerned. You know, the brand awareness, you know, understanding where the product, what the product is all about, that kind of thing. But as far as the bottom funnel is concerned, you know, the performance part of it, the purchase part of it, where are we exactly with regards to bringing all that into the OTT streams? Is it possible, you know, while watching, am I going to, like, there are a lot of connected TVs today. Am I going to be watching it on a screen and going click to, you know, buy a product? Is that even possible?
So I think we can think of ourselves as marketers, or we can think of ourselves first as consumers of content. Right? If I'm a consumer of content, honestly, if I'm deep into a content, I will not want any distractions of clicking into a link and going and being taken away from that content. Right? So from that perspective, we don't need to be everything. OTT doesn't need to be everything. The fact is that it can add to TV significantly with the strengths that it has in terms of being able to allow a brand to build its story, in being able to target consumers sharper than what TV can do in that whole effort. So I'm not sure whether you really want to spend time trying to become relevant from a performance marketing perspective at all. Why should we do that? There are other mediums for that, isn't it? I'd rather invest more time to become extremely good in the whole brand building space as a platform, right? So if you ask me, I wouldn't try to actually, become relevant from a performance perspective if I was an OTT platform.
Prateek, do you agree?
Yes and no, I'll chime in with a couple of thoughts. One is the fact that, like, while we don't agree that, this new normal or the first wave, as you call it, didn't hit OTT platforms, it did, right? And it hit them in a good way, right? They were pretty much expecting that I will grow this volume of subscribers or this volume of people watching over 2 years, 3 years, 4 years, right? And their product roadmap was always built on that 2 year, 3 year, 4 year pipeline. For instance, if, in my opinion, if last year Dream 11 would have not jumped onto the IPL bandwagon, the integration of Dream 11 inside of Hotstar in the IPL, if it was in March or in April of 2020, as opposed to September or October in 2020, would never have happened. The integration with somebody like a Swiggy into Hotstar would have never happened. So a lot of the product roadmaps for OTTs have also accelerated to allow for these integrations to happen from a middle funnel point of view.
Okay.
Right? It's not necessarily top funnel or bottom funnel, right? Like, we often forget that there is a middle funnel right over there. There are lots of new products that are becoming a part of branded content, which are there to change habits, right? To give you an example of a lot of the house rental or no broker portals did content, branded content, that allowed people to understand that there is a change in habit from calling your local broker or asking your watchman for a local broker to a professional service that actually exists. Does it create awareness for me? 100%, but it also creates consideration for me. Does it get me my bottom funnel as of where I'm sitting right now? Absolutely not, because my bottom funnel, like I said before, the metrics are, did I click on the link? Did the link get converted into a sale? It is too well defined for a platform that is too early to evolve into those kind of metrics as we're actually sitting. So 2 points, right? So while I agree that where we don't have the relevant inventory, we do not have the relevant tech inside of OTT platforms as of where we're sitting right now. But as people, migrate, those innovations will start to come to life. People will start to understand what is the content community commerce sort of a model that exists even for content creation. And as of where we are sitting today, can we do branded integrations to drive consideration? Yes. Can we do branded integrations to drive sale? Maybe not. Or bottom funnel? Maybe not. That's my take on it. So I just think it's evolutionary. It's not necessarily going to happen or not going to happen, because a lot of experiments are going to succeed, and hopefully a lot of experiments are going to fail.
Okay. Anuradha, I'd like to bring you in. We spoke about this earlier. Some of the popular OTT platforms today are ad-free, like Netflix, Amazon Prime, and they have a significant amount of dedicated viewers with them. So what are you, as far as GSK is concerned, how are you going about, breaking that wall? How are you bringing GSK into these SVOD spaces?
Well, it's a little selective, honestly, where, as you said, that currently it's not open for advertiser space, which I think is very good in a sense, because I think The first and foremost, and I think Ashwin touched upon that briefly, which is be a consumer first. Yeah, what would you really like? And so, you know, live streaming content has its own role. OTT has its own role. So first is content traction. And so sometimes you're looking at, you know, whether that's, you know, you even evaluating opportunities of in-program placement. You're talking to, you know, content creators and seeing whether there's any, you know, role of participation. And we are a healthcare organization. So look, we definitely, we believe in authenticity. So for us, the kind of content also that we'll be talking to will come with its own, you know, stamp of authenticity. You know, we are not a flashy business. By definition, oh, people have to trust us and look for solutions, be it Sensodyne, be it, you know, be it Eno, be it Otrivin, be it Iodex, be it Crocin. Look at the brands we're talking about. And therefore, by definition, the kind of, you know, partnerships that we seek are either depending on stature if we need. So for example, a Sensodyne partnering with IPL, sure. As I mentioned earlier, Game of Thrones, sure. So there the role is impact. Integration is a different vehicle. Later, as and when ODT evolves, and clearly I think the writing's on the wall that it will, there will be a role of advertisers. And accordingly, will also evolve, you know, literally a surrogate of high definition where people will still pay more perhaps for uninterrupted flow, which is a different revenue model altogether for this entire framework. So it'll be a full circle. They will get into advertiser framework. They will, you know, entail participation, probably even e-commerce integration, absolutely, and seamless, because many other markets have moved there. You click a button and you like something, you can buy that, you know, food, you can just order right away, etc., which is a seamless integration without being too interruptive. And at the same time, there'll be enough consumers offended and will want a free advertiser, free content framework as well. So that's how it'll possibly go. And we are pretty much, you know, evaluating at this level in an integrated manner. I think I'll just possibly say integration is the name of the word.
So, you know, because you were talking about OTT as an extension of TV, tell me, how important is catch-up content for both of you, Anuruddha, you and Mr. Srivastava both? You know, are you going to be spending enough monies on it? Do you think there is scope there, you know, where something plays on TV and then you want to catch up the same episode on these OTT platforms? Is it a good opportunity there? Or is it just something you can overlook? Catch-up content.
Would you like to go first, Mr. Srivastava?
Go ahead.
All right. So again, going back to what we've been saying, which is it totally depends on the content. If it has repeat viewability potential, you know, it could be events. It could be marquee sports events where people will come back and watch maybe highlights. It could be, you know, movie events. Of course, there is repeat viewing. So just like you would evaluate it from a TV perspective, that they, you know, you estimate a certain TVR for fresh content, and then you estimate a slightly lesser, and you know it's like a downward curve. That's exactly the kind of maths that you would do in terms of, yes, there'll be a certain traction, and accordingly you figure out whether it makes sense to your overall strategy or not.
Okay.
Yeah.
Mr. Srivastava, you want to talk about it?
Yeah, so surely we will. We do look at on repeat content as well. So catch-up content, as you say, yes, it depends on the content as well as I think the financial part of it, because you do have one of the advantages of OTT is that you can do catch-up. You know, so that is the thing which also makes it a lot of viewers come there for that purpose also. So yes, we will we do look at it. But for me, the more exciting part is when the 5G technology comes in and you can have an immersive streaming happening, maybe live content happening. That's something which, you know, really exciting me. Because once you have the bandwidth, normally if you stream 4K videos, you require 30 Mbps. But if you have live, then you require 60. I think we are getting there technologically. That is going to open a lot of advertising opportunities, I believe. And I think that's what we are all excited about. That's what makes OTT the really evolving platform it is.
You know, you're talking about technology and reach. You know, you have an audience base in both rural and urban India, and there's this explosion of vernacular content. So tell me, would you want to put in your money in a Hotstar which has sufficient amount of vernacular content, or those vernacular only OTT platforms which have emerged like OiChoi or Sun Next, you know, which are more beneficial according to you?
Yes, so I think those vernacular ones are evolving also. The interesting part is, when I mentioned about the cross-visiting across platforms, it is much lesser for vernaculars, the platforms which have vernacular content. Yes, so surely for a brand like ours, which we have a lot of selling happening in areas which are, you know, more localized in that sense. At the moment, OTT subscribers, a large base is still, urban, a large base. But the nature of the platform makes it possible to do that geo-targeting very, very easily. And I think that is also, as we go along, when we get good content in vernacular, and we are getting almost every day we have news that something is coming up in the vernacular OTT platform. Mm-hmm. I think that would give us advertisers many more options. And surely Maruti Suzuki will look at that, because we are a brand which have sales across the geography of the country.
And coming back to the media experts, tell me, how does one, we spoke about how it shouldn't be upper funnel, bottom funnel, all of that. But can we increase engagement on OTT? I think Netflix had, way back in 2019, had started something with Black Mirror, where the viewer could control the ending of, the show on based on his preferences. And that really did engage their audiences better. Can we do something like that with advertisers as well, wherein you can ensure that, audiences are watching and reacting?
No, absolutely. I think a lot of the ideas, in fact, were discussed earlier as well. Especially when we're working on branded content, you can bring in a lot of innovations and to drive engagement. It could be even things like you could scan a QR code during the course of the show, and then you can interact on your mobile, play a quiz on your mobile. So there are multiple ways in which you can drive engagement. You may call me a traditionalist in that sense, but if there is a pure piece of content which is just entertainment and not branded content, which is also entertainment, you create branded content from an entertainment perspective, I would, as far as possible, make the brand integration natural and subtle and write it into the story. As long as the brand plays a role in the story, it embellishes the story and it embellishes the brand both. I think that's the challenge so if you ask me, you'll need to go back into writing versus saying, let's do this innovation from a tech perspective. So if you want brands to start featuring in content in a manner where they add to the story and suddenly the story adds to the brand, we should start writing, and which is what we've started doing actually. We have done about 3 shows in Tamil recently where we had brands coming into the show, but we got into that phase when we were writing the episodes, we were writing the brand into the episodes as a part of the story rather than as an afterthought. Okay. And I guess, which means automatically it requires a lot of planning. It's a more strategic engagement, like Shashank and Amrita both said earlier. You want to choose the content that you want to associate with. So all those decisions start coming in. So it's a more involved decision than just advertising on a piece of content, right? So I guess to drive more engagement, you will need to plan ahead of time, and you will need to obviously put a lot more effort to be able to do that.
Okay. Pratik, you want to add to that?
So Neeta, we've already done it. We've already created interactive content where you can make brand choices as you keep moving on. This is something that way back in 2019, we did it for brands. We could not do it on OTT platforms at that particular point in time, because like I said, OTT platforms did not have the technology to allow for decisions to be made on the fly. We use the branded content and we ran it on social media platforms so that brands are able to make these decisions. So innovation is already happening in the branded content space. Like I said in my previous answer, we're waiting for the technology and the products on the OTT platforms to catch on with the kind of innovations that we can therefore suggest to them. And what Ashwin is saying is fairly correct, because the construct of the way content creators and advertisers are working, right, has to change massively. It usually is that you create an IP and take it to advertisers. Advertisers say that we're interested. We're now getting into spaces where advertisers are commissioning IPs, which is a very different space than integrating with already existing IPs, right? So once you're commissioning the IP, then you're writing for that particular brand. The perspective completely changes, the writing completely changes, the integration completely changes. And so, you know, for me, you know, the shorthand of what we're discussing today is that it's obviously evolving at multiple levels, right? We're talking about, you know, we're talking about looking into the future and looking into, you know, into what it holds. But different players, the advertiser, the content creator, you know, the OTT or the technology provider, will all have to play substantial roles in being able to push it in a certain direction. And you know, we'd all as a collective have to try lots of things, fail, and understand what is actually working. You know, we're just sitting in that juncture of evolution. We're probably expecting it to happen a lot faster than it can. That's my only fear at all ends.
Okay, we are kind of running short on time, so I have this one last question to ask, or rather feedback to give. So you know, world over, there's this constant battle between TV viewership and OTT. A lot of markets have already evolved. OTT reigns there. You know, even in India, a lot of my friends, you know, have completely given up on their DTH, you know, connections and subscribe to multiple OTT platforms. So basically, to quote a dialogue from the film Deewar, you know, OTT ke paas rising internet proliferation hai, video on demand option hai, appointment viewing ki zarurat nahi hai, advertisers bhi hai, TV ke paas kya hai? One line response from all of you. Anuruddha, you go first.
Heritage and metrics.
Okay. Ashwin?
I would say OTT bhi TV hai.
Okay. I'm Prateek.
I would say habit. Habit.
Okay. But habit to change kar sakte hain.
Hum change kar sakte hain, right? Like, but there is a whole population out there for whom TV is the centerpiece of the house, which will take a while to change. And I think like Mr. Srivastava said, I don't think we need to compete. You know, I think we're all going to eat out of a growing pie. I don't think we need to be the, you know, the ants trying to pull each other down. I think we need to all be trying to create a honeycomb that we can all eat out of. So I'm not competing at all. So TV ke paas digital hai is all I will say, and digital ke paas TV hai is all I will say in that context.
Okay, on that note, PwC 2020 reports that India is currently the fastest growing OTT market in the world, expected to touch revenues to the tune of $2.9 billion. You know, we've seen OTT gaining at the expense of cinemas last year. But like Prateek said, we should not be competing within the platforms. But still, I want to say I'm really, really curious to see how soon it will give TV a proper run for its money. And before it becomes a preferred choice of entertainment for the country. And thank you so much, everybody, for joining us, and especially the panelists for making this such an interesting discussion. Thank yous, and stay safe, everybody.
Thank you. All the best. Bye-bye.